Hi and welcome to LawWiser. We'll be trying and understanding different concepts that revolve around maritime law, and we'll go in depth on that. Our today's first video focuses on decoding the Admiralty Law. And to discuss this and decode this law, we have an expert with us. We have Mr. Gautam Bhatikar. He's partner at Phoenix Legal. Thank you, Gautam. Thank you for taking time out for us.
Thank you for having me.
First, you know, one of the common concepts that we hear about is arresting vessels. So if you can quickly explain to us, you know, what is the concept and the legal framework on arresting vessels? Also, how has this law evolved in India?
Sure. Let me answer the three questions that you've raised. That's one is what's the concept behind admiralty jurisdiction or admiralty claims or possibly arrest of vessels. And I'll also deal with the history behind how this law has got evolved over the years. So firstly, talking about the concept, I think concept purely is for deciding on maritime claims against vessels. And these concepts are basically largely driven by in rem proceedings as against in personam proceedings, which are normally civil cases which are filed in personam in nature. The concept again is also derived from the CPC called the attachment before judgment. So you arrest the vessel prior to the judgment as security for a maritime claim or a lien as the case may be for any claim that any claimant would have against the vessel or for that matter have against the ship owner. Now this is in short the concept behind the Admiralty Law and the arrest of vessels in India. In addition to that, if I look at the general consensus of what's the Admiralty Law all about, now in the recent times in 2017, the first act in India was passed called the Admiralty Jurisdiction Settlement of Maritime Claims 2017. This act was slightly different from the prevailing law earlier and gave jurisdiction to all the coastal states, or rather the high courts of the coastal states, to deal with maritime law or for that matter admiralty law for arresting of the vessels. In addition to that, earlier it was purely within the 12 nautical miles, the courts would have jurisdiction. Now it has been elongated or largened to a large extent to go up to the exclusive economic zone. Now that's about the 2017 Act. Now, if you look at the history per se, now, as we all know, 95% of business across the globe or the trade across the globe is done through shipping. And it's one of the very important pieces of law when it comes to international trade. Now, if this goes back in history, now sometime in the 19th century, during the British colonial era, Admiralty Courts Act 1840 was passed in England and was made applicable to India as well. Thereafter, this law was replaced or repealed, and the maritime law, the next one which came into force, which was the Admiralty Courts Act 1861. Thereafter, the Colonial Courts of Admiralty Act 1890, and then 1891, which was the Colonial Courts of Admiralty India Act, came into picture. In addition to that, in 1865, there was a Letters Patent Act that was passed, which gave jurisdiction to high courts like Mumbai, Madras, and Calcutta, as they then were, jurisdiction over arresting of vessels which came into India and there was a default on those vessels. So this was largely what it was then. Post-independence, there was no law as such passed, which eventually got passed in 2017. So it was the high courts and the Supreme Court started dealing with these cases. And the first of its landmark judgment came in 1993 called the M.V. Elizabeth judgment. Now there are multiple conventions that are available across, and there are signatories to those conventions. For the first time in 1993, the Brussels Convention of 1952 was made applicable, not by signing the convention, it was more that the Supreme Court in M.V. Elizabeth dealt with the Brussels Convention on arrest of vessels, and on that basis we had the Brussels Convention indirectly made applicable to India. So in 1999, the Geneva Convention formed part or was included in several judgments. Some of the important judgments which dealt with arrest of vessels on various claims, one was MVC Success in 2003, Nizuru in 2004, Kapitan Kud in 1996, Altisubar, which is a recent judgment in 2019 dealing with security towards arbitration in a foreign state, and there was MV Mariner 4, which are some of the important judgments which formed part of the Admiralty law in India. Thereafter, for the first time in India, we have the 2017 Act. That was the first act post-independence, which is a codified law on admiralty proceedings. I think that's to sum up the whole history of how admiralty laws were dealt with by Indian courts. And finally, the 2017 Act that came to be passed as a codified law.
Thank you, Gautam. This is actually quite interesting to, you know, hear about, considering that, you know, most of the laws were actually, they did come in some form or the other post-independence, and that, however, Admiralty, considering that we have a long coastline, somehow the need for having a codified law post-independence never really arose until 2017. We, as you can say, relied much on the courts for their judgments and, you know, how they interpreted the conventions, right?
Yes, you are absolutely right. There was a bill that was drafted sometime in the early millennial. However, it could never be tabled. It was just pending. But eventually, in 2017, the law came to be passed.
That is interesting. So, moving further, you know, as you mentioned about arresting vessels, what do you think, especially if you can highlight for us the filing of proceedings under admiralty jurisdiction, and how are they actually different from civil or commercial cases, if you can explain that to our audience?
I think at the start of my talk, I think what I mentioned was the proceedings in admiralty are in rem proceedings. That's against an object rather than against a person. Like in personam proceedings are normally against an individual, which can be a company or any other entity. So in admiralty proceedings, what happens is you actually file proceedings to arrest a ship which is within the Indian territorial waters. And for that, you file a normal proceedings, just like you file a plaint in the court. And in addition to that, as to what is the claim, what are the documents in support of the claim. In addition to that, you need to file a judge's order. Secondly, you need to also give an undertaking. That's the claimant gives an undertaking that he will provide security in case the arrest is eventually decided to be wrongful. In addition to that, there would be a caveat registry search, which is normally taken under the admiralty jurisdiction. And a certificate is normally given by the lawyer that he has taken the search in the court and there is no caveat against arrest of that particular vessel. So this is how the normal proceedings are filed. When it comes to going to court, most of the proceedings, or rather, unless there is a caveat, most of the proceedings are ex parte. So you go straight to court. There is no notice to be given to the ship owners, and you can arrest the vessel on the basis of a prima facie case that is made out that there is a claim and the vessel is within the Indian territorial waters. On that basis, the court gives an order of arrest by signing the judge's order, which is then served on the master of the vessel or their agents or possibly the ship owners. That's how the normal proceedings take place. Now, in addition to that, what happens is once the vessel is arrested, the ship owner needs to come and enter his appearance. If he enters the appearance and provides security for the claim, then the vessel is allowed to sail and the security then remains as the security that is required prior to the arrest of the vessel. So that could be possibly by way of a cash deposit, or it could be by way of a bank guarantee of a nationalized bank or a first-class bank, which the court or the protonotary accepts. After that, the proceedings can proceed as a normal proceedings, the way any proceedings would proceed in a civil case. If in case the ship owner doesn't come forward, then the arresting party can make an application for the sale of the vessel. And in an auction, the vessel is sold and the money that is being procured or the money that is being got under the auction is deposited in court as security. This is how the normal proceedings happen. Then in normal proceedings, the way you have a trial, you have the final hearings, all these follow in the same manner like the civil proceedings.
Okay, that actually kind of helps us more understand what's the procedure, because somewhere it's similar, but although it has its own, certain procedures when it comes to appearance of the ship owner and, you know, such other provisions as required. So what are the claims under maritime law for arresting vessels?
In the new Admiralty Act, earlier that wasn't the case, but under the new Admiralty Act, Section 4 deals with all the possible claims from A to W, where all the claims are actually mentioned. So roughly giving you an idea, I'll not go line by line, but I'll just explain. So any dispute pertaining to a possession of the vessel or the ownership or a dispute between co-owners, a vessel can be arrested. Also, for construction, reconstruction, or any claims related to repairs of the vessel, that's also a maritime claim. There could be loss or damage to the vessel or goods on the vessel or loss of life. Anything to do with or connected with operation of vessel where the claim arises, the vessel can be arrested on that basis. In addition to that, there would be claims related to a mortgage or a charge, which is a maritime lien, dispute arising out of agreements, which could be the dispute relating to a charter party, which is hiring of the vessel, or a bills of lading, which is carriage of goods or passengers from point A to point B. These are again maritime claims. In addition to that, which is very, very important, which is essentials supplied to vessel. Now, what I mean by essentials could be any necessaries, including bunkers, that's the oil or lubricants. Those cases can also be filed against the vessel or for that matter, owner indirectly for recovery of that claim by arresting a vessel. Then you have claims which are towage claims or a pilotage claims, brokerage for that matter, for while selling or buying a ship or any other claim. Port dues could be one more claim, which is very important. Then you have the crew claims, which are claims from the master of the vessel for their salaries. There could be other crew claims of first officers and other crew members. There could be salvage claims, where the vessel has gone and had to be salved, or then there it could be claims for damaging the environment. So these are the roughly the claims that are there. But Section 4 deals with it in a more robust manner.
So basically, Section 4 actually deals with it quite exhaustively and has a huge list that can come under, or the various claims that can arise under the law. So So moving on further, how can the ship owner defend these claims, or whether can they defend these claims?
The ship owner has a right to defend the claim at multiple times. So first would be if the ship owner is apprehending any kind of proceedings that may be filed against the ship, then he could firstly file a caveat against arrest, which I mentioned earlier, a certificate is needed. So that's something that the vessel owner can file to avoid ex parte orders being passed against them. So that's one thing that can take care of to a large extent, where he can put forth his case at the initial stage itself before the arrest. Second possibility is once the vessel is arrested, the ship owner can put up his claim or put up his security, and then possibly agitate the claim, saying that it's a wrongful arrest. So that wrongful arrest could also be one of the points where the ship owner secondly could also defend its claim at the time when the vessel is arrested, and at which point in time he can put up a security and have an application made to the court for wrongful arrest, which then gives him the chance to agitate this before the court and demonstrate that it is a wrongful arrest, should the case be so. Otherwise, the proceedings will proceed on the basis of the security that is provided by the ship owner, and it will be eventually decided on merits after the trial is concluded. There are possibilities that there could be multiple claims as well. Like for one ship, there could be claims from possibly a crew, possibly a bank, or maybe various other claimants. At which point in time, what normally would happen is the ship owner will have to defend these multiple claims coming together.
Thank you, Gautam. This actually kind of does help us understand, what are these claims that, ship owner can actually defend, and there can be, multiple claims as well under this. So how do you think India is as a jurisdiction when it comes for admiralty law? What are the advantages for considering India, especially for admiralty proceedings, in comparison to its other counterparts in the world?
See, most of the jurisdictions across the globe, you need to put up counter security for arresting the vessel. As against that, in India, you need to just put up an undertaking saying that eventually if the court decides that a counter security is required, only then a counter security is required to be put up by the arresting party. Secondly, in India, the advantage, what I could see, is arresting of sister ships. Now, what do I mean by sister ships? If there are two ships within the same company, and arresting one of the vessels have been a defaulting vessel, and the sister ships that comes in India, you have a right to arrest that vessel for a claim showing that it's a sister ship. Thirdly, the other advantage is most of these contracts in shipping, or most of these contracts for carriage of goods, are governed by either charter parties or bills of lading, which are normally governed by English law and having a seat of arbitration outside India. Now, in the recent judgment, which is Altus Uber in 2019, the court has clarified that even if the seat is outside, the proceedings here in India are for security, and a vessel can be arrested for putting up security, and the security will remain for the eventual award that will be passed in the arbitration that may be that may take place under any contract of carriage or maybe hiring of ship or any other contract where the ship is involved or the ship owner.
Thank you, Gautam. Thank you for actually explaining us admiralty law, the common concept or the known concept of arresting ships, claims, and you know also how India is a favorable jurisdiction as well. So thank you for quickly taking us through this. And thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for having me.